Hey, art family, if you like this one, the full-length version's on Patreon.
They are skidful.
Hello, art family, and thanks to all the new subscribers. For this video, I decided to do a demo of this setup, kitchen setup, of fried green tomatoes. I'm going to start off by blocking in a bunch of the big shapes that I see. This is just the underpainting, this is just the colors that I'm hoping to kind of shine through, but I want to take every opportunity when applying the paint to try to preliminarily draw what I'm looking at. So I'm just trying to mass in some of those shapes with a little bit of the local color and just make some notes, just some squares and some places to set myself up. It's kind of a form of pre-drawing before I get to the actual drawing part, which is what I'm doing now. I'm also using a very high key of color, which is to say very intense, bright color saturation. For my own particular paintings, I tend to paint things fairly gray and muddy and low saturated because I get very caught up in the rabbit hole of focusing on the value arrangements and the big kind of puzzle pieces, and I don't care as much about the actual specific local color as much as maybe I could or should. And so for me, it helps to kind of front load any sketch, whether it's watercolor or gouache, with a lot of high key saturated colors that will shine through in the end. If you were to take this approach in a more kind of grounded in tradition method of kind of, it's sort of borrowed from the alla prima method of oil painting, then you might want to do all this with burnt sienna or burnt umber or maybe yellow ochre, although some people would say that that tends to make the painting look jaundiced, although I like the way it adds like a glow to the painting. So I tend to use a lot of yellow ochre in the beginning, and I like that bright pink personally because it just adds a nice vibration between the cracks and parts where the two colors touch. But if you're using this method and using strictly yellow ochre, burnt sienna, burnt umber, one particular color, then it's nice because when you get into the drawing phase, if you're using that, you can erase very easily. It's a very forgiving method. And I personally like this method of approach to drawing the scene because I tend to think more sculpturally this way. It was kind of a big breakthrough for me in my sketching because I used to do these very tightly renders of the scene that I was looking at or the object that I was looking at, and I'd get very caught up in the contour lines and getting a detailed drawing done before I would get into the painting. But I find this method, I tend to be a little bit more loose, and I tend to think a little bit more sculpturally, especially when I get to this phase, when I'm starting to put in the colors. When I say thinking sculpturally, I mean that I find myself thinking more three-dimensionally around the object, the 3D space of the object, and less about the contour lines that kind of represent the object. When I'm painting, I like to find a particular kind of local color spot, and then think of that as a sort of pixel. And then I move from there, radiate out from there, always asking myself, is it getting warmer or cooler or lighter or darker? You know, am I moving towards the light source or away from the light source? And if so, is it being affected by a secondary light source? You know, in this case, we have two prominent light sources, which is pretty typical for an indoor still life that's not specifically spotlit. You can really see that represented if you look at the highlights on the red tomato to the left. So I'm placing it, I'm just basically blocking everything in right now. And I'm not really concerned about edges. I'm going to work on that all later. In fact, I'm going to use a spray bottle at the end, cover up the elements that I want to keep sharp, and spray the rest of it to allow it to sort of dissolve. But if you look at that tomato to the left, the red tomato, you can see a series of highlights across the tomato, and I want you to kind of pay attention to the color temperature. When I say color temperature, I'm talking about whether it's warm or cool, which is to say, of course, if it's warm, it's pitched more towards the orange. If it's cool, it's pitched more towards the blue. So if we're looking at those highlights, you can see a direct representation of the objects that are creating those highlights. It's an angle of incidence that creates that highlight, where the light is bouncing directly into your eye. So you can see on that tomato to the left, we have a couple highlights, right, where the light is bouncing off, and that is our light sources that are being directly reflected back at us, and that informs me a little bit, because this object is shiny, relatively shiny, it's informing me about what kind of light is lighting up this scene. So I can see the highlight closest to me is the kitchen light up directly above this scene, which is a warm interior light. And then you can see behind it, contrasting it, is a cool blue highlight, which is the window off to the back left of this scene. So we have two main light sources here, and they're generating a warm light and a cool light. One light is very strong, which is lighting up the scene, that warm light coming from the inside, and the other light is more of a fill light. It's just sort of filling things, like shadows, where it's not really strong enough to illuminate the scene necessarily. So I'm working around these objects, and I'm trying to remove myself from the awareness of knowing what these objects are, and focus instead on the planes that are created by these objects in three-dimensional space. Of course, the tomatoes are kind of spheres, they're shiny material. The bag of flour is a big rectangle, it could be a shoebox, it could be anything. But what I want to focus on is that I have a frontward-facing plane, and then a top-facing plane that is facing closer towards the light source, so of course it's going to be a little more illuminated. In fact, you can kind of tell when I put in that top plane, it immediately made the scene feel a little bit more three-dimensional. So my main area of focus is blocking in the colors that I'm seeing and the shapes that I'm seeing, focusing on these planes, and as I move from plane to plane, asking myself, is it getting lighter or darker or warmer or cooler? You know, which light source am I moving to? I'm asking myself, how is the light being bounced around the scene? You know, we have this red tomato near a white object. Well, it's going to cast some of that orangey red light onto that white colander. Same for the green tomatoes. It's going to cast some of that green light on the lower part of the flower bag and on the lower part of the colander as well. So all the while, I'm focusing on trying to make sure that my value relationships are reading, and I'm taking every opportunity I can to correct and kind of smudge or move the drawing as needed to correct it as I go. I want to make sure that those elements line up in two-dimensional space. As I often say in these videos, I'm focusing primarily on the big shapes of these objects and elements and trying to get all the big elements working before I start to get into what I'm doing now, which is kind of noodling away at some of the detail, getting into the smaller parts that are less important. Once I'm happy with my major shapes working, then I can sort of treat myself to putting in the highlights, which is what is going to sell a lot of the sort of material differences between these objects. So you can see I'm using a lot of blue here. Well, some blue, I should say, and a whole lot of white to get this strong, cool blue highlight, then cleaning the area and switching over to the warm to get those warm highlights as well. Having a little bit of cool and a little bit of warm in those highlights is going to go a long way in selling the real three-dimensional space of this scene. It's something that people see all the time, constantly, but they don't really have a word for it. So if you can find little moments like that, pick up on those kind of color tendencies and use that knowledge in your sketch, it'll go a long way in the way of selling the kind of three-dimensionality of a scene. People won't specifically have a word for it, but it'll just sort of click. They'll go, it'll just look more real, more luminescent to them. And that's why it's really crucial that if you're a newer painter, you do a lot of painting from life, because you're downloading into your own personal library a kind of mental visual vocabulary for those kind of elements that light can do that you can use when you're sketching from a photograph. Now, for my own life, because I have kids and a lot of stuff going on, I don't have time to necessarily paint from life every single time. And so, you know, for this example, I'm using a photo reference, and I often use photo references, or otherwise I probably wouldn't get any painting done when it comes to these kind of side paintings or kind of exploratory studies. But what I have done is I have been able to put in a lot of time painting from life and building that sort of visual color vocabulary that I can bring into these paintings when I'm painting from a photograph. At this stage in the sketch, I feel like the exploratory phase is sort of done. I still have a couple little elements that I want to put in, but for the most part, it's finished because I feel like the lessons have been learned. So from here on out, you could just sort of noodle away and do any amount of detail you wanted to do. You can kind of call it done at any point. I tend to stop short of really fine rendering on pictures because it's more an exploratory thing, exploring the kind of colors and materials and the way light affects them. So that's going to be it for this demo of some fried green tomatoes. I hope you got a lot out of it. I appreciate you watching, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.